Collections, we have 12 collections. Sorry, my bad. I thought it was 11. These range from the Ordnance Survey collection, which is the oldest one. It's the one we've had for the longest, right through to agricultural census data in the Ag Census collection, which is our newest one. We also offer bundles of collections by way of purchasing options. There's the Ultimate, the Premium, and the Standard bundle, and each one includes a range of different collections. All universities and colleges will subscribe to a selection depending on their particular requirements. We license mapping data from different agencies and companies for educational use. We don't produce the data itself, but we do process it. We make it look nice. We format it in a way that makes it easy for you to access and to use, but we don't create the original data. As such, we are subject to license restrictions on what we can do with it, and we pass on those license conditions to you too. Our website is there if you haven't yet found it, digimap.edina.ac.uk. Also like to draw your attention to the help pages we have, which cover details of the maps and the data that we have. There are details of all the different map products. The data download has different categories of data and a product information box for each data set, which will give you a bit more detail about it. Where we think it's appropriate, we point to the original data supplier's website where they already have the information. There's not much point in us replicating the stuff in our website too. Do take a look at the help pages because there's quite a lot of information there. We have also tried to break down activities within the service into small chunks so that they're easy to follow. So for example, I want to find a map of my house. You can do that in different stages and the help pages will detail how to do that. We also have our YouTube channel, which has got lots of videos on how to do things. This webinar recording will go onto YouTube when we've done it. Do have a look at YouTube because there are lots of small chunks of videos, short 1 minute, 30 second things on how to do particular things. Always worth a look. So the three applications I mentioned earlier are Roam and the data download and the web map services. Roam will allow you to browse maps, will allow you to print in PDF, PNG or JPEG, I think. You can customise your maps with either your own drawings over the top. We have a series of overlays built into the service that you can add to the backdrop map, or you can bring in your own data and maps from other sources if you want to using the web map service. You can add images, you can add text, you can add points, lines, polygons and so on. If you have a GIS application and you wish to use the raw data in your own system, then you need the data download application. That will allow you to retrieve particular data sets, particular areas of the data in order to process in your own software. You will need something like ArcGIS or QGIS or AutoCAD in order to do that, but we will give you the raw data and after that it's up to you what you wish to do with it. The web map services section will allow you to view our maps in other software with a link. So you still need to log in, but you don't have to download or store the data or manage it. It is a way of piping the backdrop mapping into your own GIS application without having that data management overhead. It's very useful. It can be done with many other data sets that are available through WMS facilities out there on the web. Do remember that these are run by third parties and therefore availability depends on how the operating party runs their service, and that will also determine speed and things like that. We'll cover that in a bit more detail later. Quick look at Roam before I launch into a live demo, which always makes us a bit nervous. We have a separate Roam for each collection. So there's the Ordnance Survey Roam, there's Aerial Roam, Geology Roam, Environment Roam and so on. And each of those offer the different data collections that come from different data suppliers. The layout and the key functions are all the same. So if I go through the Ordnance Survey one, you should be able to translate the things you learn from that through to any other Roam. It's fairly straightforward to be transferable like that. The features available do vary a little bit depending on the maps in a collection. So for example, with the historic maps, we have the ability to compare two maps of two different dates side by side. For the geology data, we have the ability to click on the map and get an active legend. So the key on the left-hand panel will show you what you can see rather than everything that's available on the whole map. We'll highlight some of those differences as we go through. Key items on the Roam window is the top toolbar, which will give you tools like printing and information button, and the side panel, which will give you most of the functionality, including all the drawing tools, the save your own maps, add your own data, measurement tools, and the information about the backdrop maps you're looking at. The map window itself also contains a drop-down list of different base maps. These are different types of maps that are available at the same scale that you're looking at. And of course, we have the zoom in and out bar on the far right. Here is one example of the maps you can produce in Rome. So you can add lots of different overlays to it, which we'll show you in the service itself. You can add your own drawing tools. As you can see here, we've got buildings added to this. You can see the underlying map. You can also see the overlays panel on the left-hand side here. Excuse me. This map shows us adding external data and using a WMS feed that is hosted by what used to be Scottish Natural Heritage. I believe they're now called Nature Scot. They offer WMS feeds of all sorts of data that it's open source data. It's publicly funded and therefore it's available. And you can bring any of those into Rome so you can overlay those onto the backdrop maps that we already have. Data download I will cover very briefly because it's could go on forever. So I'll show you roughly how to look for the data that you need and how to download it, but I won't go through it in too much detail. It's very straightforward to select an area, choose your data set, choose a format and hit download, and you get an email saying when it's ready for you. I'm going to skip the copyright for the moment and come back to it in a bit. But for now, I'm going to see if I can share my screen and talk you through Digimap Rome to start with. Let's try and share. Let's go to... Oh, hang on a minute. Excuse my terrible Zoom skills. Here we are on this one. Viv, you'll have to shout at me if you can't see.
Yeah, it's looking good. If you can maximize the browser, that would be great.
Yeah, okay. Is that there? Right, so you should be able to see Digimap now. All good.
Yeah, all good.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to open the OS collection to start with. I'm already logged in. You can tell I'm already logged in because it says, welcome Emma here. And I can click log out if I want to. Key things to note up here are the help button, which will open a new window with all the help pages like that. These are all split into different categories. Do have a look at those because there's a lot of information in there. I'm going to go back to my homepage again. I'm going to start with the Ordnance Survey collection. So I'll click on the Ordnance Survey tab. And I'm going to start with Rome here. This opens the Rome application. As I said before, we've got the top bar here, which gives us various buttons for locating me, printing information button, which will become available in a bit. I can toggle a two-up view, and that's to help me download data. In the left-hand panel is the majority of the functionality. The search button is above that, and we also have various links under the drop-down list there. Zoom in and out is on the far right here, but I can also use the scroll wheel on my mouse to zoom in and out. Let's start by searching for Nine Elms. So if I just press the return key or hit the search button here, you'll find that it searches whatever I type in. The search will come up with two different options. It gives me a places option, but it also gives me a roads option. So you can take your pick depending on which one you're looking for. I'm going to pick Nine Elms in Greater London. I'm hoping this will take me somewhere close to Battersea Power Station. That's it. I can zoom in and out using the scroll wheel. First, I'm going to close the search button there, and you'll see the search marker disappears. I can zoom in and out using my scroll wheel, or I can zoom in and out using this button here on the zoom bar. As I zoom in and out, you can see that the maps change. This is because Ordnance Survey create maps that are designed to be viewed at particular scales. As you change the scale, we try to display a map that is most appropriate for the scale that you've picked. Inevitably, if you were looking at the very detailed data and tried to view that at a national scale, you'd get one great big blurry mess. You wouldn't be able to see anything. Similarly, if I was to display the road atlas style data at a very, very large scale, so very, very zoomed in, you wouldn't really see anything. You'd just see one colour. So we try to change the maps automatically as we zoom in to get something that's always going to be appropriate. I'm going to zoom right into the most detailed data we have. This is what we know as the OS master map data. And I'm hoping, I had hoped to see if I could find a power station, but I can't see it. Ah, where is it? Where is it? There it is, just a bit too far south. So as I zoom right in, you can see that this is the power station, and that's as far in as I can go. Now, this is clearly a big building, and I'm very zoomed in, so I can't see all of it on the screen. So I'm going to use my scroll wheel and zoom out a little bit more. I'd like to show you the map information panel here on the left-hand side. This will give you all the information about the map that you're looking at. So this tells me that the map product is OS Master Map. This is the most detailed stuff that Ordnance Survey produced for the UK, for Great Britain, sorry, not the UK. It gives me the date of the data and also tells me which license it's available under. Ordnance Survey offered two types of data. One is licensed, and that is the stuff that we pay for, and the other is open data. Open data is freely available from Digimap and from OS directly. You're allowed to use that for whatever you want to, as long as it's not illegal. It is designed to be free and designed to promote economic growth and activity and so on. So that's why it's free. That was a 2010 initiative. It also gives me a default print scale, and it will tell me what projection the map is in. You can also see what the map extent is that I'm looking at here. And as I move my cursor, you can see that the grid reference of the cursor is marked in that and changes as I go along. If you want to capture particular coordinates, you can use this button at the end here. So if I then click on a particular spot, that then freezes my cursor position so that I can copy and paste the text from this map information panel there. Let me show you the base maps too. So I'm going to zoom out a little bit more to give you a bit more detail so that we can see the context in which Battersea Power Station is there. It's next to the railway, next to the river. The base maps tab in the top left-hand corner of the map here shows me how many other types of map I have available at this scale. So the OS Master Map data is the full color version we're looking at now, but we also have a line drawing version. This will look very similar to what many of you may know as the landline data. Landline was the precursor to Master Map. It's ancient now, but some of us remember it with fond memories. This line drawing version looks like that, but it is in fact still Master Map. As you can see, it is just a not coloured in version. As I zoom out a bit more with the base maps tabs open, you can see that there are other data sets become available. OpenMap Local is an open data set. So you can see here that OpenMap Local is under open data in the license on the left hand side. If I keep going, we should find that there are more alternative data sets become available. I can then just pick and choose which one I want to look at. So if I choose the vector map, VML stands for vector map local, I can have a plan version, or I could have the raster version. I could also have the standard colored version. If I keep going, we'll start to recognize things like the 25,000 data, which is, some of you may know, is the orange explorer maps that OS produce on paper. Keep going a bit further out and I will find that I get the 50,000 data, which some of you will know as the land ranger maps. These are the digital equivalents of those paper maps. We have a backdrop version of vector map district here, which is useful if you want to draw your own annotations over the top, because it's slightly faded and therefore you can see your annotations a bit more easily. If I keep going still further, I get to road atlas type data. This is the 1 to 250,000 scale data. Obviously, if I was viewing this at a scale of 1 to 500, I may see only a pink blob or a grey blob, which is why we change the maps available as the scales change. Keep going yet further and you can start to see a much broader view of the country with the major arteries of transport, and you can see the coast, and the scale of course dictates what is and is not, you're not visible on that. Again, there are different versions of this. This is the mini scale data. We have a background version, and we have a relief version, which will also give you an idea of where the mountains are. Let's zoom back into Battersea again. Let's go back to our search and click Nine Elms again, and we should find our map zooms into a more appropriate scale. There we go. I'll shut the search box. Let's go back to the more detailed data. Let's look at the map content tab here, which is the second tab down on the left-hand side, these three lines. This will show you the content, it's a key, show you the symbols shown on the map. Again, as I zoom in and out, you'll find that the key changes. For some layers, the content of your map can be customized, in which case the map content section here will have lots of checkboxes in it. So let's do something a bit daft, but really obvious, and just remove all the buildings from the map. This level of customization is only available for some maps. It's only available for those that are made out of what we call vector data rather than raster data. So when you see the word raster in the base maps tab here, you'll find that there is no customization available. But if you use the original vector data, then you can customize your map to show the different features that you want to see. So we can show them all, we can hide them all, like that. Let me show you the drawing tools next. So I'm going to go back to the master map version here, zoom right in, and I'm going to show you the drawing tools, which is the fourth tab down here on the left-hand side. It is a little pencil icon. The drawing tools will allow you to add your own annotations to the map. There are points, lines, polygons, labels. You can add images, buffer zones, and so on. First, I'm going to add a marker. So if I open the markers here, I get to choose a different type of marker. I'm going to choose a blue dot. And I'm going to add a marker to the middle of the power station here, just to show you what it's like. If I wish to draw around the edge, I can use the polygon tool here. This will open the different shapes that I can use. The most useful one, I think, is the draw polygon one. So this is quite straightforward, where you click and drag your mouse, click at each point to change direction. I'm going to do this very roughly for speed. If I keep going, every time I change direction, I have to click. And when I want to stop drawing my polygon, as in I've finished doing it, I just need to do a double click to fix it. Double click there. Once my polygon is there, I can select it using the select button. It will turn yellow, and then I can change both the line settings and the fill settings for it to make it green. And then if I click anywhere else on the map, it becomes unselected, and there is my polygon. Let me show you the overlays next. The next tab in the left-hand side here is the overlays. It's three little squares layered on top of each other. The overlays will allow us to add data that is pre-built for you. So you could do this yourself in a GIS, but we do it for you here just to make it a little bit easier. I'm going to start by adding the points of interest data. So I tick the box here, and you'll see that the little bits, little icons appear for all the different types of points of interest. Points of interest is a data set created by a company called Point X and is sublicensed to Ordnance Survey. So we have it under a sort of third party license, which means the restrictions on what you can do with it are a little greater than for the rest of the Ordnance Survey data. Sharing it is a no-no, publishing it is a no-no, using it for geocoding data sets and marketing is a no-no. But if you have any questions about that, please come and ask. As you can see with the overlays, I have an option to select different types of the points of interest. So in this particular one, I'm going to choose to hide all the layers except the education and public health ones. And as you can see somewhere, I should come back. Let me zoom out a little bit. I should find that. Have I ticked the right one? Let's try a different one. Let's try eating, drinking, and accommodation. There we go. So we can see that these icons appear depending on what I've selected in the panel on the left-hand side. If I select the info button here, I should be able to click on these and it will give me the information about that particular point. So this particular one is an eating and drinking establishment, it's a restaurant, gives me the address and lists all the others that are at that location as well. Let me add a buffer as well. I'm going to take the points of interest off for the moment just so that our map is not too cluttered. I might just show you the postcode boundaries while we're here, because they are very useful and interesting. depending on the scale of your map, these postcodes will appear either as individual postcode units, so one whole postcode. So this one here is SW118AB. The little squares are what we call vertical streets. They are denoting buildings that have more than one postcode in the whole building. So tower blocks are a good example. Maybe only five floors of a tower block have one postcode, and next five floors have another postcode. Clearly, they all have the same footprint on the ground, so they're represented, the postcodes are represented by a square. As I zoom out, you'll find that the postcode boundaries change to become a bit more readable. It's very hard to see individual postcode boundaries at a very zoomed out scale because they get really blurry. So as I zoom out a bit further, you can see that they get sort of merged, if you like, and you start to see the postcode district boundary and the sector boundary and area boundary rather than the individual postcode units. That's just something to be aware of. Next, I'm going to go back to the drawing tools and show you the buffer tool, because I think this is really useful. When it comes to establishing things like how many, stations you've got within 5 miles of a particular point, this can be useful. So if I click on the buffer tool and I set my buffer radius, so let's say 5 miles, and I'm going to do a 5 miles within the radius of Battersea Power Station. I click on Battersea Power Station there, that will draw me a circle that is 5 miles in radius. So I'm going to have to zoom out because, of course, 5 miles is quite big. And there you can see the sorts of things you could count within the 5 miles. Let me remove that one. If I want to delete a feature, I can use the delete on click button. Just click to remove that particular feature. We're back to Battersea Power Station and see if I can show you the linear buffer. If I was to follow a railway line, I can use the buffer zone here and do a line. And let's say I want a buffer of 100 meters of the railway line here. So I'm going to go from this railway station. I'm just going to click each step to draw a line along the railway. This might give me an indication. Double click to finish, and that will give me a zone that is 100 meters within the line that I've drawn. You might be useful for things like noise pollution or flooding or coastal erosion, all sorts of topics to cover there. Right, a quick pause. Viv, have we got any questions?
Nothing at this point, Emma.
Okay, super. Right, I'll crack on. How am I doing for time?
You've got plenty of time.
So, good.
Yeah, 20 okay, minutes left.
Super. Right, I'm going to clear everything. I'm going to delete all my drawings by clicking the delete all button, and I'm going to start again by doing this. So I click the button underneath the zoom bar. Next, I'm going to look at a wind farms map to show you how to add different things. So I'm going to zoom in on this area here a little bit, and I'm going to show you the overlays in the WMS tab. So if I go to the drawing tools and I go to import, I'm getting muddled. I need to go to the overlays tab and I need to go to the WMS tab within that. And this will show you how to add WMS feeds from external sources. I've already got some added here. So Digimap offers WMS feeds of its own data, which you can use to pipe the data into each collection, into other collections, or you can use it to feed into your own GIS application. What I've done here is to add this SNH Renewables WMS feed. The way to do it is to click the manually add WMS feed button, and then I can find the URL from the SNH website and put it in here, and it will add the layers to the map. I'll show you that one in a minute with something else. Let me show you the ones that I've already got here. I'm going to add the WMS feed renewables here. I'm just going to turn all the other ones off. And if I expand this list here, you can see that all the different layers of data from SNH will appear, and then I can add and remove them as I want to. So this feed is run by SNH. We don't control it, whether it's available or not, or whether it's fast or slow. So there is a bit of a caveat there, but it is quite useful. So I'm going to zoom in a bit more, and we will start to see that we could have just the renewables layer in here. I'm going to turn off the wind farms, peatland stuff, and the carbon stuff. So those layers shouldn't appear.
Emma, sorry to rudely interrupt. I need to leave for another meeting.
Okay.
Thanks very much. Very informative.
Nice to see you.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
So the SNH renewables come in here, and I should be able to see where they appear. It's maybe being a bit slow today. All right, let's try the onshore wind farm proposals instead and see if that works. Again, this illustrates the point that these WMS feeds are run by other people. This is a live demonstration. and if someone else's system is not playing, then we're a bit stuck. There we go. Just takes a bit of time. So the onshore wind farm proposals are here, and you can see roughly what the layout is like. If I try to add the renewables as well, we may find that will work, but it just takes a bit more time. This is where you can bring data in without having to download it and manage it or find it from other places. I can also add data that's come from elsewhere within Digimap. Let me turn off the SNH renewables one. And let's zoom in a little bit more, and we can see the historical maps from Digimap. So if I turn the historical maps on here, I'm just going to open this tab and switch on some layers to see if they appear. There we go. So now we can see the base map. Underneath, you can change the opacity of the overlay here in the side panel to make sure that the map underneath is more or less visible. This takes a little bit of time to catch up, so using the slider is a bit tricky, but you can see the idea is there that you can change the opacity so that you can see the new and the old developments underneath. Okay, any questions about that?
No questions at the moment, Emma. Thank you.
That's good. Okay. I'm going to turn the WMS off. I'm also going to show you how to add your own data. So if we go to the drawing tools again, and I'm going to zoom out so we can see the whole of Scotland. That's most useful. You can import your own data from various sources. You could either have a shapefile or a KML file. GPX is something that comes from a GPS unit. So if you have a fitness tracker watch or an app on your phone, you can track where you've been and upload that. CSV file is the obvious one if you want to add point data, or a GeoJSON file is another geographical format. So I'm going to add a CSV file of all the Munros in Scotland, which are all the mountains over 3,000 feet. So I click browse and I find my CSV here. I'll show you the CSV file in a minute. Open that, click import, and we should find that after a few seconds, I get options to choose the X and Y coordinates. I'll show you the original file in a minute when you'll see where this has come from. So I choose the X and Y coordinates and I click OK, and we should find that imports all the points of the Munros over 3,000 feet. There we go. So I can zoom in on any of these, check that they're all in the right place. As you can see, all the peaks are marked with the markers there. Let me show you the original file itself. If I open the CSV file, I hope you'll be able to see this. There we go. So the file is a simple CSV file. It has a number of key items in it. Oops, what's going on there? It has the height, and it has, most importantly, the X coordinates and the Y coordinates of each point. And Digimap uses those coordinates in order to place the markers on the map. So it's a very simple CSV file. You can add as much extra information in it as you want, but it's important it has this X coordinate and Y coordinate. The import function will allow you to choose the headers, choose which column you need to use as your x and y coordinates, but it does that it doesn't matter what you call it, it's, as long as it is, as long as it is a coordinate value. So those. Okay, so while we're here, I'm going to show you how to download data. Let's zoom in a little bit so we've got a rough idea where we're looking at. So let's change the base map to something really obvious. Let's use the 50K because that's really popular. If you want to download data for this area, there's a button here with a little cloud. This will allow you to select the area you're looking at for download automatically without having to redraw your selection. So I'm going to click this and it will open the data download application for me with the area I was previously looking at already selected. So let me do a quick overview of the data download tool. This has the same search function as Roam, which allows you to search for location. It has drawing tools which allow you to specify the area that you want to download. This doesn't add annotations to your map, but it allows you to select the right area. There are other options for selecting the area you want to download to using tile names or visible area, or you can import your own polygon, or you can use a set of coordinates. Underneath this is a list of all the different data sets available to download. So you can pick whichever one you like. Let's pick the backdrop mapping. I'm going to choose the 1 to 25,000 raster. If I click the arrow on the left, on the right here, it will open an extra box, which will tell me a little bit more about the data set I'm downloading. Once the box is checked and I've chosen my data sets, I can then click Add to Basket. This will allow me to select the date, the version of the data that I want. In some cases, it will allow me to select a format, and it will also allow me to select whether I clip it to the exact boundary that I've chosen or not. Let's add some more data and I'll show you some other functions there. If I want to select OS master map data, I haven't selected a big enough area, that's interesting. I'm going to zoom out a bit. I'm going to select a bigger area to illustrate something. I'm going to click the draw area box. I'm going to select a huge area like this. Now, in the left-hand panel, you can see that there is an automatic calculation done on the size of the area that you're trying to download. Some data sets have a restriction on how much you can download in any single request. That's to allow us to manage both the licensing restrictions and to manage the traffic on the Digimap service. That doesn't mean to say you can't come back and order some more. You can, but it means you can't order more than a certain amount in any one request. So for the topography data, which is the very detailed master map data we looked at for Battersea Power Station earlier, you can only download a maximum of 100 square kilometres in any one request. You can come back and make another request, but in one go, you can only get 100 square kilometres. This calculation here in red will tell you how much you've selected through your orange box on the left here, on the right rather. It will also allow you to, it won't let you download that because you've selected too large an area. The trick is to then reselect your area to a smaller chunk, let's say half that. And then we should find, oh, I'm still too big, so I can select it again to make it smaller. And then it comes under the limit and I will be allowed to add it to the basket. So if I tick that one and add to basket, I can then select both the date of the data. This one goes right back to January 2007. Datasets are of different ages, so some of them are updated more frequently than others. Some of them are newer than others and therefore don't go back as far as 2007. Some go way back to 1999, depends on the product. And other datasets will allow you to select format. So the formats vary depending on the product you want, so you have to pick one that's available. And in some cases, you can select individual layers from the data depending on what you're looking for. Once I do this, I can then request, oh, I haven't selected format, that's what's wrong. I can then request the data. This will send me an email and it will tell me when the data is ready to collect. The email will give me a link. I click on the link. I need to log back into Digimap in order to retrieve the data and download it. Okay, I think that's everything I want to say on data download for now. Let me go back to my slides. I wanted to talk about copyright. I'm going to go do this. There are my slides. Okay. I've gone too far on my slides. I need to go back one. Been very slow, sorry. Okay, done data download. Copyright is fairly straightforward in that everything Digimap offers is licensed for educational use only. That means private study, research, teaching, learning. Anything that is vaguely commercial or might make any money is almost certainly out, but we are very happy to answer any questions about it. If you have any doubt at all, please ask. We are here to work our way through it. If something doesn't look like it's permitted under our license, there will be a license somewhere that will allow you to do what you want to do. It's just a question of helping you find it. All the maps you use have to be acknowledged. There's a copyright statement on all the maps produced from Rome. They are on the screen in the service and they also appear on any of the printouts. If for whatever reason you're creating your own map and the acknowledgement is not there, you need to add it. All the license agreements are in our help pages. We also have a section on citation guidance for those people who need to reference the use of Digimap. We've given some examples of how it should be done. These are not prescriptive at all. They're just designed as guidance and help for people who've not had to do this before. You may have other specifications that you wish to use. That's absolutely fine. This will give you a rough idea of what to put in. Also, when you download any data, there is a citations file that comes with the data, which will help you to create that citation as well. It will tell you what you've downloaded, when you downloaded it, which tiles it was, when it was updated, all the sort of useful information about where it's come from. That, I think, is a whistle-stop tour of everything, but we have plenty of time for questions if anybody has any.
Emma, we've had a question from someone who's a little bit unsure about the WMS side, and they're not sure. How do they know what WMS are available? Would you be able to flip back and go to a collection page to show them where they can find a WMS or a service?
Yes. Right. So if we start with the Digimap homepage here, you choose a collection and the WMSs for this collection are all listed at the bottom of this right-hand panel here under web services. So what you will see here is two different feeds. So these are feeds of the Ordnance Survey data that Digimap holds. One is for the licensed data and one is for the open data. Similarly, if we look at the historic one, we'll find the web services link there. There is the feed for that. Let me show you how to link the two. So let's, for example, say I want to put the Ordnance Survey data into Environment Digimap. So I'm going to get the license data for the link here. I'm going to copy it. I'm just using Control C. Just do this, right click, copy. I'm then going to go to the Environment tab. If I open Environment Rome this way, I can then go to the Overlays tab here, click on WMS. I'm going to manually add a WMS feed. I'm going to paste my link into this top field. I'm going to click Get Layers. This takes a little bit of time. It goes back to the server and it picks out all the different layers it can find. The layers will be listed here. At this point, I can say whether I want them to be visible or not. So I can change these icons to be visible or not visible. And then I click Add Layers to Map. So as I zoom in, you should find that it appears somewhere here. Just shorten that one. There is my OS license data. Actually, I've added it before, so it's still there, but this is the one I've just added here. And you can see all the layers appear in the underneath. So as I zoom in, I should see this error you can see over the top is in fact a caching problem. We've got a little bit of a bug where it doesn't seem to acknowledge that I've switched off the historical stuff, but it will go away in a minute. So as I zoom in, I should find that the data becomes available. I can then add and remove individual layers as I wish. So if I take off everything except the master map line drawing and the vector map local stuff, I should see it appearing over the top. Super. As I said, we are here by email to ask any questions at any time. The email is digimap@edina.ac.uk. Don't hesitate to drop us a line if you do have anything that you think of later.